Also, I think my head is taller than yours.
Looks like it.
I don't know. Hi, everybody. I'm Jim.
I'm Ryan.
And this is the Concept Crucible Podcast.
And today we talk about philosophy.
Teaching philosophy.
I know, this is weird. When we were doing the pre-show, this is one of the few topics where there's a natural evolution with something that happened in an earlier season. Because in season 1, episode 13, we talked about our philosophy stories.
Yeah, and how we got into that racket in the first place.
And now we're returning to the topic of philosophy, like specifically academic philosophy.
Arguably, we've never left.
Arguably, yeah, I mean, true, we've never left. But now we're coming back to talk about, like, the next evolution. Like, I feel like I'm a Pokemon in some regard.
You're a Pokemon in several regards.
Yes, I'm not going to deny that. But we're going to be talking about teaching philosophy.
You enjoy rare candy.
I really, like, I put on weight. I have enjoyed a lot of rare candies. That exercise thing, it didn't work out so well last year. When we got back from Scotland, and then I started teaching.
We ate a lot of rare candy in Scotland.
That's the thing. Is as soon as I got back from Scotland and then started teaching, just exercise right out the window. There's no training involved there.
All right, so
I'm a Snorlax.
Speaking of training.
All right.
You last term taught your first philosophy course.
Yep.
Like taught, not just TA.
No, yeah, for the first time. So prior, actually no, we'll talk about our cred in just a second. So yes, I finally taught start to finish, 4 months, administered lectures, graded essays, wrote essay questions, wrote an exam, delivered an exam, looked for plagiarism. Like I did everything for the very first time.
Nice. And so we're going to talk about that.
Yeah.
But first, icebreaker.
Yeah.
What is your favorite topic to discuss or introduce in discussions of philosophy?
So there are so many that we could possibly talk about. It was really difficult to pick out a unique exemplar. The one that I ended up choosing for myself was relevant to what I taught last term. We did a discussion on addictions, which when I was prepping for the lecture, I realized that I didn't have enough clinical experience to discuss addictions in any kind of meaningful sense. Yeah, mm-hmm. I mean, I used to work in a gambling lab, sure. And I have a basic understanding of how addictions, you know, biochemically work.
Mm-hmm.
But having never been addicted to anything that I know of, and having not really any kind of lived experience, I didn't feel comfortable really talking about it. And so I briefly discussed it and then used that as a framing device to talk about the great chestnut of free will versus determinism. Which, I mean, if anybody who's really done any philosophy, and Jim rolled his eyes when I first talked about it.
I continue to roll my eyes.
Yeah, I mean, free will versus determinism is kind of like, what's that? You discussed it. You know, the second year philosophy student that kind of finally...
It's not even. So free will and determinism is the conversation I have with muggles at parties.
Yeah, no.
They find out I have a philosophy degree.
No, but what I mean is it's supposed to be that big thing like... It's the kind of when the sophists try to catch you up in a distinction or whatever. You know, the second year philosophy student who knows just enough philosophy to talk circles around people. But
I remember being that person.
Yeah, no. And when you bring it up or when you're trying to stump somebody, you talk about it. So, I mean, yes, in some sense, when I taught it, I was doing it to troll my class, I guess, in some sense, which is kind of mean of me to say. But basically what I did was I said, okay, without reference to any readings, because I brought this up in class. I did not prepare them for this, right? Mm-hmm. So unfairly, they walked into a poo-poo landmine kind of deal. I said, here is a basic definition of free will. Here's how you can think about it. Here is a basic definition of causal determinism, because we had just talked about addictions. So I'm like, I set it up. You know, mm-hmm. if addictions is rooted in a kind of physical understanding of the brain, you know, biochemistry and whatnot, what does that say about free will? You know, we have this intuitive sense of free will. We have this understanding of the reality of addiction. What does that say about each other? And then I basically spend the next hour and a half poking holes at what the various students were trying to say to kind of reconcile these two ideas. I'm like, well, what do you think about free? Who thinks we have free will? Right? Who thinks we have determinism? Okay, like we kind of went back and forth on that, and I was trying to draw out of the students, you know, like, okay, well, what about this? What about this? And for every time that a student would be like, well, what about this? I'd be like, well, yeah, but think about it like this. And then, so like I had one student who by the end of it didn't really know one way or the other. I even brought in the idea, and I in class, I'm like, I cannot remember the study. And I had to look it up afterwards. But when you throw somebody in a like an fMRI and you study their brain will make a decision
before they're consciously aware of it, right?
I'm like, so what about that? So like a student had...
Link to that study below,
by the way. Yeah, so a student had thrown a pencil at me to try to make a point. And so I like rebutted. I took the soft case of my clicker so that it wasn't hard in case I hit them in the head. And I threw it back at them. I'm like, yeah, if we stick you in an fMRI scanner, your brain would have made the decision to move and catch that before you had consciously decided that. What does that say about free will and determinism? It was an hour of me poking holes into the students. One student...
Don't physically poke holes into your students.
No. The Swiss cheese is not the way to go. One student did get smart, though. They did the whole thing that you should always do with Socrates of, okay, Socrates, like, you say all these things are wrong. What do you think? And a student, they're like, well, what's your answer to it? And I'm like, bah, well, I don't know. I'm undone. And I think I even made reference to that in the class of, like,
I'm melting.
My goal here is not to tell you a set of dogma. My goal here is just to get you to think about it. So I kind of back.
Free will and determinism? Like, I understand that you had a really good pedagogical experience, and I'm super jealous.
Yeah, it was. I was not trying to convince them one way or the other. I was trying to just get them to think through these kind of, I'm going to say the false dichotomy, because I really only presented it in one of two options. And in the summary of the lecture, I said, look, like, I was talking about hard determinism. There's a whole branch called soft determinism, which tries to reconcile these two. I didn't even give this to you as an option, but some of you were starting to go.
Please, here's 1,000 years of reading.
Yeah, yeah. So I admittedly, I stacked the deck for the purposes of trying to teach the lesson, but that was a lot of fun.
I feel like the basis of teaching in some way is stacking the deck for the purposes of teaching the lesson.
Yeah.
It's why you learn the like orbital atomic model, and then they replace it with the electron cloud.
Yeah.
And they're like, listen, that thing you learned, forget that.
Yeah.
Don't worry about that. That was useful then. Now you need to know this.
Billiard balls to orbits to clouds to just
probabilities. Yeah.
What about you, Jim? What's like, you haven't taught explicitly in an academic setting. So what's your favorite
topic? So most of my philosophy discussions happen out in the world, on the internet, so in person. And I like discussion-wise, I'm a big fan of a bunch of sort of like discussion-y tools, like granting things for the sake of argument and doing that thing where you're like, okay, yeah, let's say that all that's true. Here's an unacceptable conclusion from that.
Reductio ad absurdum.
They involve less murder now than they did when I was in in university.
Yes, there was a lot of dead babies.
No, there weren't. There was one. You make one example.
I will never. Where it made a point. I never forget that example.
It was a good example.
Yeah.
Like I didn't, because you make it sound like I cracked a dead baby joke in a class, and I didn't.
No.
It was that Kant thinks that only rational people are persons worthy of moral respect. Or he in a sort of very roundabout way. I'm not being as charitable as I could be. But and somebody was like, well, what does it say about animals? And I was like, or babies. Hmm. Like, any ethical system that says it's okay to just straight up kill babies, like human babies that you can hold, we probably don't want that one. We need to make some revisions.
Yeah.
And that was the point of that.
I know.
And I am never going to live it down. Probably I know
not.
That. But
probably not. You were wearing fatigues and combat boots.
Yeah, I know.
And you had a short cropped hair.
It was a different time.
It was a marked.
That was a different man. But no, my favorite one is probably Peter Singer's moral evil principle. Because I one of the other things I enjoy is the sort of 1-2 punch of here's a thing that you find completely uncontroversial. Here is the necessary conclusion of that. Mm-hmm. And so Peter Singer made a very simple declaration. Now, Singer's a famous consequentialist. And I don't agree with him on a lot of things, but I agree with him on this. And it was the idea that if you have the power to stop people from suffering, to stop suffering from happening, you have an obligation to do so. Full stop. Like, if you fail to do that, if you neglect to do that, because it is within your power to stop it or to alleviate it, and if we don't, we have committed a moral fault. We have done something wrong. It is wrong to do nothing when you could do something. Mm-hmm. And like that's powerful wizard shit. Mm-hmm. And it leads us to all kinds of like weird ass conclusions that I like, some of which I find more palatable than others, mm-hmm. but all of which I find sort of interestingly compelling. It's why I'm a vegetarian. It's Peter Singer finally got to me. Peter Singer, also a vegetarian.
Yeah.
You know, it's, and then he used the example of the drowning child. A kid, you know, falls through the ice.
Famine, affluence, and morality. If we don't have a link below, just make sure to Google it. That's like the canonical paper.
Yeah, that you should check out. We'll definitely throw a link below. I'm pretty sure it's online. But yeah, and it's this idea of should you save that kid? And the answer is yes. It's like, okay, well, should you save that kid if it means risking your own life? Still yes. Should you save that kid, you know, if it means risking someone else's life? And there's like, well, it gets more complicated. Mm-hmm. But if we accept the first two, then there's open questions about, you know, why don't we give away more money? Like, if we have the power, if money is a form of power, and we have that, and we can use that power to alleviate suffering, why don't we give away more money than we do? And there's a bunch of like interestingly complicated answers to that, but it is one of those things where I find it useful, partly because I buy into it, and partly because Muggles find it really compelling. Mm-hmm. In a conversation, so it shortens your conversation a bunch, where they're like, oh yeah, oh, huh, huh.
The entire first chapter of my master's thesis was acknowledging Singer's point and arguing that he collapses a distinction between aid and rescue that I totally want to maintain.
Yeah.
And that was the entire crux of my first
chapter. There's a whole bunch of really complicated stuff in the sentence.
Yeah.
If you have the power to alleviate suffering, you have an obligation to exercise that power. Like, there's a whole ton of stuff going on in there.
Yeah.
And I love unpacking it, which is the other reason, which is why I would happily do that for hours and hours and hours. Mm-hmm. So, but to talk about teaching. Mm-hmm. So street cred, I have never taught philosophy in any kind of official capacity. Mm-hmm. I have written course material, I've written tests and stuff like that. I've done a bunch of TA work. Mm-hmm. I've graded exams and things like that, but I have never, like, lectured a class on philosophy. I've done some public speaking on it. Mm-hmm. I have written a bunch of blog posts, which you can find at conceptcrucible.com, back mm-hmm. when we used to do a whole bunch of public philosophy stuff and a lot of, like, philosophy 101 mm-hmm. bits. But, yeah, I've never stood in front of a class of students for a term mm-hmm. and taught it.
Yeah.
And I'm super jealous. It sounds like a lot of work, but it sounds like a blast.
Yeah. So my street cred up until, what was it? When did he first contact me? July. I was already course loaded to teach by July. March or April, I think, was when I first the opportunity first arose. But up until then, I did not have any formal experience. I also had TA'd, and actually, my TA work was probably less than yours. My TA work was probably mostly grading. I was mostly marking. I very rarely held office hours unless it was after I graded for students to come and discuss their grade with me. I did not really write any tests. They were always pre-written by the professor. I did not build a lot of formal academic curriculum. I did do a fair amount of public speaking. And I had developed or helped to develop curriculum for stuff in the community, like, for example, the Community Foundation's their Engage program. I mean, the curriculum was already there, but I was a part of the team that reviewed it. So I had tangential experience, and then when the job posting that they were looking for professors of philosophy went up, I sent a message to the chair. I'm like, hey, like, what are you looking to fill? Because it looks like you only need a master's degree in order to fulfill the criteria. And he said, and he sent me a bunch of courses, and he's like, you know, we're looking to fill these. And I said, well, here's my CV. You know, I updated it that afternoon. Here's my CV. I admittedly don't have the teaching experience that you're probably looking for, but if you want to discuss anything of it, I'm more than happy to come talk to you. And like 10 minutes later, he's like, yeah, let's meet tomorrow. I'm like, okay, let's do this. And I figured it was going to be one of those kind of like 1 hour bullshit sessions. Not bullshit in the bad sense, but like he and I sit down, we talk for an hour, and then he'll be like, okay, I like you enough, yeah, you should apply for the job. I thought it was gonna be one of those things that we go back and forth.
Yeah, or you're not ready for this yet, but yeah, here's how you can improve to make yourself ready.
Yeah, well, and like, and he could, like, depending on the kind of person, like, I didn't know who he was at the time, but depending on the kind of person, he could politely tell me to throw my hat into the ring, knowing full well that I would never make it through the HR pool. Mm-hmm. Like, I would be automatically selected out. So, like, whether or not he was comfortable saying, no, absolutely not, do not apply, versus, you know, so I thought I was just going to meet with him for an hour, and then he would suss me out and be like, yeah, you know what, throw it in. If we don't have anybody better, we'll hire you, kind of deal. No, I met with him for an hour. We talked about critical theory. We talked about Nietzsche. We talked about existentialism. We talked about epistemology. We talked about me being a bouncer. We talked about me working in a gambling lab. We talked about all sorts of things for about an hour. And then he's like, well, so you can't teach this one course because we require PhDs to, it's a complicated ministry requirement that you need a certain number of PhDs teaching into a degree program. So we need as many PhDs on staff. He's like, I can't really give you this course, but I think you'd be perfect to teach this one. Do you want to teach it? Not like, do you want to apply for it? Not, do you want to send your resume to HR? It's, do you want to teach it? Can I talk to my current boss to see if I'm going to break any rules by teaching it? Yeah, you know, give, like, message me in 24 hours, kind of deal. Oh, okay. And so that's how that happened.
So you spent a term lecturing college students on philosophy.
Yeah.
And what is the sort of most interesting part about that? Like, I really enjoy the sort of mental calisthenics of it.
So, I mean, on a personal level, it was interesting trying to figure out on the fly whether or not I could actually do it. Because it's one thing to, you get a curriculum from somebody else. It's another thing to know the material enough to be able to deliver it. But from a kind of teaching point of view, it was just such a unique experience. I mean, it's not like you can just download facts into their head. And I stole this idea from Paul Thagard, where I allowed the students, or I encouraged the students, at the end of every class to write up to 3 questions on a piece of paper, submit it to me, and at the start of the next class, I would answer them in some sense. Some of them were personal, like, hey, which bar do you work at? But there was one that the student honestly asked, like, in earnest asked me, not honestly in the sense of I don't believe that they asked me, but they asked me in earnest, what do you think you're going to teach us over this course, and do you think you could teach us to be wise?
That student's a smart ass, and I don't like them.
No, this student, I know the student who had submitted it, and I believe that she had asked this question honestly. Not skeptically, just wanting to know, I guess, maybe how confident I was. Fair. And strangely enough, so that I answered this in the second lecture when I invited Sarah to come in and sit in and watch,
mm-hmm.
Because, you know, she was incredibly proud of me to be a teacher. I also invited my stepmother in to be a guest lecturer for a part of the discussion. So I got my mom to sit in and watch, you know, her baby boy teach his first philosophy class.
You giant nerd.
And at the same time, I was answering this question, will you make us wiser? So I said, okay, short answer, no. I won't make you wiser. I said, the best I can hope for is to make you think a little bit better than when you first came into this class. It wasn't important for me that they learn the specifics of who said what their theory or what their, you know, account of the world was. That wasn't so important to me. The more important thing for me was for them to examine evidence, to critically examine their opinions, to get them to stop saying "in my opinion" as a form of evidence, and for them to be able to reason better through problems. That was the most I said I could hope for. Not for them to figure out what answers will get Professor Huckle to give them an A.
Yeah, it's one of the weird things about, like, there's always that thing that people remark on. Again, Muggles. And I use the term sort of charitably to refer to lay people, which is in itself an uncharitable term.
No, true.
But is the idea that philosophy will teach you how to think, rather than teaching you like an assortment of facts, like a geography course does.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and even a geography course, that's a little mean to them, because you learn how to interconnect different facts in a geography course. But nobody ever really, I think, until you get sort of deep into the meat of it, has an idea of what it means to learn how to think.
Mm-hmm.
And often it looks like a bunch of really weird mental exercises.
Mm-hmm.
I always think of, like, the problems with analogies and thought experiments. Like, you know, you do, like everybody uses the example of Plato's cave as a sort of weird, silly thought experiment. But I really like, Judith Jarvis Thompson wrote a paper in the 70s in defense of abortion. It's the People Seeds one,
mm-hmm.
and the famous violinist one. I'll put a link in the show notes. But, and she made probably the strangest analogies I've ever read.
I certainly hated it the first time that I read it.
Oh my God, it was so good.
I missed the point the first time I read
it. And it took me a while. Like, it's one of those things where I come back to it, you know, over, what, 5 years now. And it took me a while to appreciate the fact that her analogies aren't just weird. They're deliberately weird because we always want to overextend.
Mm-hmm.
And so with such a, like, weird niche analogy, like, you wake up one morning and there's a famous violinist hooked into your kidneys. If you unhook them, they will die. Is it okay to unhook them? And under what circumstances? And they were hooked up without your consent.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And they're incredibly important. That's, like,
yeah, the thing. Yeah, they're a very important violinist.
Yeah.
And the world will be lesser without them. But they were hooked up without your consent, and there's a whole bunch going on. Like, I'm doing a disservice in summing it up, but it's the idea that the analogies are weird on purpose because they're designed to only apply to that and to convey very specific meaning.
Mm-hmm.
And if there's one of those things that you learn is how to be very specific, how to focus on really small questions.
Mm-hmm.
And how to understand that all big questions are composed of really small questions.
Mm-hmm.
And all big questions are sort of completely fictional,
mm-hmm.
in a really important way.
Mm-hmm.
I can hear one of my professors watching this and like wincing. But in the sense that, like, you brought up free will and determinism.
Yeah.
And, like, the answer to that question is almost irrelevant.
Mm-hmm.
The answer, you know, there's a larger question in there, or there's smaller questions in there about how do we make decisions? How do we think about the ways that we make decisions. Mm-hmm. How do we understand action mm-hmm. and what it means to take action? Mm-hmm. How does, how do we draw distinctions between actions that are voluntary and involuntary, or actions that are non-voluntary? Mm-hmm. What kind of finer distinctions exist between something that's determined and something that isn't? And like, there's a whole bunch of those questions, and the answer to those questions are the questions that really matter, and the answer to those questions are usually also questions. Mm-hmm.
That's sometimes the biggest, it's not the biggest critique of philosophy, but a lot of times people levy those kinds of questions that, first, there's the joke that there's no certain knowledge in philosophy, and whenever there is, it moves across campus, gets more funding, and is called a science, right? So, I mean, like, there's that joke, but the idea that philosophy is nothing but...
Man, when's ethics going to start getting that science funding?
I know, right? But that the people will sometimes try to critique philosophy as useless because it's full of these big, meaningless questions, or these big questions that have been around for 2,000 plus years and nobody has answered. But that's entirely the point, is answering these big, ugly, hairy questions, while are important in some sense. What is justice, or what is, you know, sure, courage, whatever. Sure. Those are, they're interesting questions, but they're not the most interesting questions.
I wouldn't say that they're interesting questions. I would say that they sound interesting, but, I mean, the answer to what is courage is answered in, I mean, what is courage specifically is a question answered not in broad terms, but in tiny moments.
Yeah.
And we see that in everything. You know, it's the truth resists simplicity. Mm-hmm. And it's easy to point fingers at big questions that, you know, haven't been answered. But at the same time, part of that is we've stopped bothering to answer those questions because they're pointless. Mm-hmm. And we've left them behind for finer and more meaningful things. Mm-hmm. Was it Tim Kenyon, who is a philosophy professor at UW? He had a thing that he said when I was in grad school, and my understanding is that it is a thing that he says, which is, if philosophy is nothing but the making and keeping of fine distinctions, it is at least that.
Yeah.
I can nerd out about this all day.
Yeah. I realized in discussing it, because we had brought up the idea of geography as being somehow the opposite of what we want to talk about, or at least...
It's because everybody uses math as an example, including me in the pre-show, and math is the wrong example.
But I thought of the perfect analogy that compares philosophy to philosophy, the kind of right way to do philosophy and the wrong way to do philosophy.
All right, I'll bite.
I won't name names to protect the innocent, but there used to be an emeritus professor who would show up, and the questions in a symposium or a colloquia talk that this person would ask would almost always take the form of, but what does so-and-so, what does Aristotle, what does Kant, what does that person say about whatever the topic is that the
and sometimes that's a really super relevant question.
Sometimes that is.
And sometimes it's not.
But a lot of the times it takes the form of, well, Aristotle said such and such, how do you respond? And in that case, most of the time, that is a kind of regurgitation of facts. That is a surface-level application of the theory. It doesn't really dive deep, and it doesn't add a lot of new, interesting, meaningful distinctions or nuances to the topic.
I was going to use the example of teaching spelling, but actually there's a bunch of really cool nuance in spelling, too.
Mm.
So what is the joy of teaching philosophy?
You mean besides...
You who have experienced it.
You mean besides...
In the most visceral sense.
Blowing minds and...
Blowing minds.
And, no, literally, like, the student could not reconcile in class. I hope that after class that they were able to reconcile it themselves. But, besides having really fun, interesting, meaningful conversations, I think it comes down to kind of two sides for me, because everything always comes down to two things.
I know, you always have two answers.
There's always two answers. There's the selfish thing, and then there's a little bit more of helping to shape young minds side of it. So on the personal side of it, I really enjoy discussing ideas. I really enjoy, and I don't mean this in the sense of I enjoy taking a kind of higher position over people because I'm smarter than them, but I enjoy introducing people to new ideas in this regard. Mm-hmm. Much in the same way I enjoy experiencing new ideas. And so I've kind of always said that my dream job would be nothing more than to teach Intro Plato to college kids, like first year college kids for the rest of my years. Not because I think Plato's right. There's a lot of stuff about Plato that I really like.
Well, I'm the same thing, only Gautier.
But
hey, when, Gautier. Hey.
But when it comes to teaching Plato, there's a lot of it can be accessible if you give them the right tools, and it's just a lot of fun. And it's kind of academic in that sense, though. So it's academic in the sense that it's focused and rigorous, but it's also academic in a negative sense that it doesn't necessarily have a lot of applications to real life. You know, so you can study Plato, and it doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to be improved morally or anything really? Like that. You can be. When done right,
I get a lot of mileage out of the Euthyphro.
No, yeah. If when done right, you can. But you can also just have a fun, happy discussion, book one of Republic, of sure. just how these are really cool, interesting conversations about different forms of government. Each of these characters in book one of the Republic represents a different kind of government. And just run with that as a really fun thought experiment. That's the thing that got me into philosophy. When I was applying off to university, I had never taken a philosophy course before, and I applied into a philosophy program. And it was only because one of my teachers, my English teachers, introduced me to, you know, deconstructing poetry. And I thought those ideas were really cool, like hypertextuality, metatextuality, and mm-hmm. stuff. I'm like, that's really cool. I don't think I could make it as an English major, but that sounds like philosophy, so I'll apply to philosophy. Wasn't exactly the smartest decision, but it seemed to work out. It was a good gamble. But the other side, just because I've hijacked the conversation a little bit, the other side that I really, really enjoy is this kind of idea that liberal studies, I think a liberal studies education is important for everybody, but the idea that what you learn in class can then be taken out into the laboratory of the real world, and it mm-hmm. allows you... It may not give you the right answers, it may not give you the answers, the correct answers for everything, but I think it adds, and this might be something that I might be co-opting one of your
yeah,
ideas. You give people more tools in order for them to engage meaningfully with the world around them, to find meaning in the world around them. That's the kind of joy of philosophy, even if it's not an academic, even if I'm not pushing the boundaries of knowledge, you know, that's what you do with a PhD, let's say, you know, if in the entire circle of knowledge, you push against the one edge and try to push it out just a little bit further, expand the circle just a little bit more. I'm not really interested in that side of it. I'm more interested in, you know, giving tools and in new ways of looking at the world to somebody and allowing them to make more meaning in the world that they find themselves in.
Mm-hmm. And I get a bunch of out of that too. Like I have talked about how I went into university without like a lot of really good ideas on how to navigate the world, and I used my time in philosophy not to become like a better person. Arguably I did, but to become sort of better at being a person and ready to person better. And there were a bunch of things that went into that, but philosophy helped me frame it. And I find that now that I am no longer a philosophy student, but instead a wordsman, I find a lot of value in those, using those sentences and introducing people to those sort of simple concepts that can help you reframe an issue or ask the right questions. Mm-hmm. But it's interesting to me that you mentioned blowing people's minds. Mm-hmm. Because I find that I gain a lot of pleasure from exactly the opposite. I find that I gain a lot of pleasure from settling people's minds, or you know, doing that. Like the notion, like, it is easy to stress out about big questions, but big questions are just small questions. And those small questions are often much harder to answer, but they in turn are more valuable than answering those big questions. You know, you can worry all you like about what does it mean to say that I'm in love with somebody? Mm-hmm. You know, and how does that affect my life? But the answer to those questions are really the answer to much smaller questions. You know, about what bits of my life are affected. You know, what kinds of feelings do I have? What kinds of feelings do they have? Like there's a whole set of questions that in turn, you know, break into smaller questions. And those smaller questions get a lot more bite-sized. Mm-hmm. And they get a lot easier to handle. And I find value and solace in, you know, sort of exercising empathy to help people. I don't want to say help people answer those questions. Mm-hmm. I'm not philosophy Kwai Chang Kane.
Yeah.
But in introducing those questions, and I have been fortunate enough to, in conversation, occasionally chill people or chill myself. The best conversations I have about that is where someone will parrot my own words back at me to settle my anxious brain. And you know, it's that idea that we say that, you know, we say that philosophy has no, or when we say philosophy has applications in the real world, we're often talking about political applications or material applications, but the ability to move through your day with quiet comfort or quiet confidence, and the ability to break down your problems or your moments into those important questions, I think is the most universally applicable thing that it does. And that is what I needed it to do for me when I came into it. And it has been wonderful to occasionally be able to use that to help it do that for other people. Mm-hmm. So is the joy not of teaching philosophy so much, but as of talking it. Mm-hmm. God. We're gonna, spoilers, we're gonna do some more philosophy stuff this season because we're dorks.
Yeah.
And we super nerd out about it, and I'm really looking forward to it. So look forward to that. If you have taken philosophy courses, leave your comments in the show notes about how great they were, how much they sucked. You can also check out our philosophy stories about how we got into this racket in the show notes, back in season 1, episode 13, mm-hmm. in Heckle Huck on Twitter, mm-hmm. about his pedagogy, mm-hmm. Or heckle me. I'm sorry, your Twitter is what?
At RJ Huck.
Or you can heckle me at Concept Crucible, and about my lack of pedagogical experience. Or pretty much anything else.
So far, anyway, I mostly
spent a bunch of time having thoughts about Star Destroyers. Seriously, who needs to destroy a star? Anyway.
The Empire.
I'm Jim.
I'm Ryan.
And we're signing off.
Stay awesome. Also, I like that there's a box. What happened? When we were recording last time, there was
there's a box around your hands sometimes? Yeah.
There you go.
Try and make your hands look like a face. I don't know what's going on.
Come on. It's like, I feel like I'm supposed to be Doctor Strange right now.
It's Leviosa.
See, now the box is around my face is angry.